I'm Jeffrey Ogbar, member of the Board of Trustees at the Harriet Beecher Stowe Center, and also chair of the Stowe Prize Selection Committee. Thank you for making the time to join us this evening, and thank you to all of our supporters, the funders, the sponsors who make our work at the Harriet Beecher Stowe Center in Hartford possible. We want to start by stating that the annual Stowe Book Prize awards a $10,000 literary prize to an author whose work illuminates a critical social justice issue in contemporary society. The book must be informed, it must provide inquiry, be accessible and engaging to a general audience, and promote empathy and understanding. Dr. Clint Smith's 2021 book, How the Word is Passed, A Reckoning with the History of Slavery Across America, is just one such work. It's deeply researched and transporting exploration of the legacy of slavery and its imprint on societies in centuries throughout U.S. History. Now more than ever, we're challenged to defend and expand how race history is taught in our country. And Dr. Clint Smith's voice and work are so important to understanding why museums and historical sites are as important in these discussions as our public schools and libraries. For more extensive conversation with Clint about his award-winning book that we did in June, please visit our multimedia gallery to watch another important conversation. Let's take a moment and thank Stowe Prize committee members whose work reading and discussing the merits of each entry in the prize takes months of work and dedication. I can say this personally, that I commend them for their tireless efforts going through so many books and tediously discussing the merits of each book with great integrity, and hats off to them all. They are Don Westbrook, Barbara Sisherman, Stephen Bayer, Andrea Barton Reeves, Joan D. Hendrick, Terry Schmidt, and Diane Cloud. And join me as we watch Stowe Center board member and Pulitzer Prize winning author Joan Hendrick award the Stowe Prize back in June.
Good evening. My name is Joan Hendrick. I'm a board member of the Stowe Center, and it is my pleasure to introduce Clint Smith, a prize-winning poet and a staff writer at The Atlantic. The Atlantic was founded in 1859 to be a beacon of culture to the nation, and the editors immediately recruited Harriet Beecher Stowe to be a regular contributor. Several of her novels were first serialized in The Atlantic, and that is where she published her bombshell, The True Story of Lady Byron's Life. Today, The Atlantic continues to be an influential shaper of political debate, as we saw with the publication of Ta-Nehisi Coates' prize-winning essay on the history of redlining. Clint Smith writes within this tradition of groundbreaking, deeply informed, and passionate journalism. As a professor of history, my first lesson to students has always been a question: who tells the story? From what point of view? With what assumptions and biases? Conventional wisdom says that the victors get to tell the story. In 21st century America, we have an anomaly. The South lost the Civil War. But for over 150 years, the South has profoundly shaped the aftermath of that conflict. They reinvented slavery under the guise of sharecropping, indentured labor, and prison labor. They shaped the story of the Civil War by propagating the narrative of the lost cause, that the war was not about slavery, but to preserve a Southern way of life. And by erecting heroic monuments to Robert E. Lee and other Confederate generals. Most significantly, by reinventing, and as Clint Smith so persuasively demonstrates, by suppressing the stories and histories of Black people, a suppression that continues in our historic homes and public institutions. I visited Monticello in 2013. We had a wonderfully articulate guide who engaged us in Jefferson's agricultural experiments, his ingenious inventions, his family, and the furnishings of his beautifully restored mansion. I came away with increased respect for the intellectual range of this 18th century founder of our country. The slave quarters were mentioned on a walkthrough, but without elaboration. That the beautifully terraced grounds were created by enormous amounts of slave labor went unremarked. Visitors were permitted to enjoy the beauty and luxury of this historic house and grounds, unperturbed by any unpleasant ghosts of the past. Clint Smith helps us to see Monticello through a different lens, not as a historic house, but as a plantation. What a difference that reframing makes.
Should we come up with a backup plan if she doesn't
make it on? A lovely place to visit
and
to imagine the past. A plantation, on the other hand, conjures up images of enslaved people working long days and possibly enduring physical and sexual abuse. That the drafter of the Declaration of Independence
is this a similar audience to the
points
one
to the contradictions
at
that
the
royal our republic.
From June, do you know?
Today,
like
these contradictions are more explicitly explored in some of our historic sites. As Smith tells us, now there is a slavery tour at Monticello. But as he points out, it is optional.
If I need to, I can just talk about the book.
And only about one-fifth of the 400,000 people who visit it each year choose to take it. It is the privilege of privilege to ignore what is challenging. It is also the privilege of privilege to be unaware of itself. Who is more aware, the person standing on someone's foot or the person whose foot is being stood upon? Clint Smith's reverence for the past is displayed in his meticulous research, matched by clear-eyed analysis and a poet's gift for language. He writes, "My parents' voices are a museum I am still learning how to visit." He is ready with striking facts. In his chapter on the Whitney Plantation, he tells us that the insurrection that took place there in 1811 was inspired by the revolution in Haiti. That one quarter of the slaves under 10 years old on that plantation died. That medical students dug up graves of enslaved people for experiments. Today, the Whitney Plantation is an example of how history can be retold from the point of view of the oppressed. Almost every tour guide there is an African-American woman. At Monticello in the 1930s, the tour guides were black men in livery. Other striking facts, a 2018 report showed that $40 million taxpayer dollars were directed at Confederate monuments. That New York City had the second largest slave market in the US, a fact noted also by Nicole Hannah-Jones in her 1619 project. It was appropriately located at the end of Wall Street. That the organizational lineage of the Sons of Confederate Veterans can be traced directly to the Ku Klux Klan. Smith spent the past several years teaching in prisons and jails. In his chapter on Angola Prison, where Alfred Woodfox, a previous Stowe Prize winner, was held in solitary confinement for over 40 years for a crime he did not commit, Clint recounts the story of Willie Francis, a 17-year-old black boy who was placed in the electric chair on May 3, 1946. The torture Willie Francis endured through a botched execution is hard to read. There were also intentional cruelties, such as the Angola rodeos, in which prisoners were tossed by bulls for the entertainment of spectators. Posters of the rodeos of the past are in the Angola Museum. Like Harriet Beecher Stowe, Clint Smith looks unflinchingly at uncomfortable, unspeakable acts of dehumanizing black people and asks us to look as well. It is not easy work, but until all of us are willing to do that work, we will not heal the wounds of the past. For his courageous reporting, his gift for storytelling, and his ability to make us see with new eyes, it is a great honor to present the 222 Harriet Beecher Stowe Prize to Clint Smith for his book, How the Word is Passed, A Reckoning with the History of Slavery Across America. Will you please come up?
As part of the 2022 Stowe Prize event, the Stowe Center asked Dr. Smith to How the Word is Passed, us, the Stowe Center. So tonight's program is a conversation between Dr. Smith and Linda Norris about what they discovered and considered when they were on site in June. It's our hope that we will gain new insight tonight along with all of you and how we can be better at the work of interpreting race history at the center. After the conversation, we'll have a Q&A. And if you would like to pose a question to the program, please email us at info@stowecenter.org at any time during the formal talk. The Q&A will then be followed by six remarkably talented poets from the greater Hartford area who've been commissioned to write original work for tonight's program. So let's begin. Dr. Clint Smith is the recipient of the 2022 Stowe Book Prize, New York Times bestselling author, poet, educator, and staff writer at The Atlantic. And Linda Norris, senior specialist in methodology and practice, International Coalition of Sites of Conscience, consultant for the Stowe Center's interpretive plan in 2017. And following their talk, you will also meet Amy Huffnagel, who is the Director of Programs and Visitor Experience here at Stowe, and versatile poet, poetic, who was our Artist in Color Accelerator in Residence, and who was also the curator of the amazing poetry that we have assembled tonight, entitled Responding to Dread. Enjoy.
Hi, Clint. It's great to see you again. I guess we're lucky we're not in Hartford where it's raining, but it's really wonderful to have a chance to chat with you again.
Likewise. I enjoyed last time and I'm looking forward to it again.
So when you were at the Stowe Center in June, you got to do a lot of different things. You took a tour of the neighborhood. You took a tour of the site, the house itself. You had a chance to see materials in the archives. You toured the city neighborhood. You got to be in conversation with frontline staff and then with me and an audience. So what we hope to do tonight is to kind of build on that a little bit more, to dive deep into what happens at the Stowe House, but also more broadly to kind of think about what that means for the museum and historic site field as a whole. So as we begin, the Stowe House tour is a little different than many other historic house tours. So as you reflect on it, what parts of the tour experience really stood out for you?
Yeah, it's a great question. You know, I have to admit that I was struck by the fact that the first thing that I saw when I stepped inside, and I don't know if this is because I entered from a particular entrance or if this is how everyone enters the space, but I was struck that the first thing I saw was criticism of Uncle Tom's Cabin by various people, or rather not criticism. It was a room that represented the sort of ecosystem of ideas and the multiplicity of perspectives of Harriet Beecher Stowe and particularly of Uncle Tom's Cabin in ways that were very honest and in ways that, you know, included both praise of the work, but also of criticism the work. You know, when you walk in, one of the first things you see is James Baldwin, sort of excerpt of James Baldwin's essay, The Notes on a Native Son, in which he criticizes the sort of literary and moral architecture of both Richard Wright's Native Son and Harriet Beecher Stowe's Uncle Tom's Cabin. And so to walk into a museum and into a space that is tasked with curating and communicating the legacy of a person, and to enter a space that immediately demands that you fully account for the totality of that person's legacy, that is sort of demonstrating from the moment you enter that it is not interested in hagiography, but is interested in a more honest reflection, contemplation, meditation on who this person was, what they created and put into the world, and what the sort of myriad implications of that were, then I think that it shows that this is a place that is much further along in its sort of understanding of the role that it is supposed to play as a historic site. And that it is a place that represents a text that means a lot of different things to a lot of different people. And to pretend as if that weren't the case, I think would be irresponsible. But instead, I was struck by how that was the very first thing you saw. And it allows people who might not be familiar with the different ways of understanding Uncle Tom's Cabin or the different ways of understanding the legacy of Harriet Beecher Stowe, it sort of immediately demands that they hold a set of multiple truths, even when they didn't realize there were multiple truths to be held.
And that is how everyone starts, I should say, not just you, it's how everyone starts. Was there anything on the tour that surprised you or unnerved you or concerned you, made you uncomfortable? You know, and we took the tour together with actually random visitors as well, which was a, you know, a particular kind of experience.
Yeah, I don't know if there was something that unnerved me. I mean, what was fascinating, and I think we talked about this a little bit afterwards, was I was particularly moved by the room. I don't remember exactly which room it was, but the space in which we all sat in a circle and sort of and read certain texts and discussed what the text and the images, like what they meant, how we were receiving them and interpreting them. And it's a reminder to me that these historic sites and the tours that docents and guides lead are never going to be the same, right? Because so much of that moment and so much of that part of the tour and so much of any tour, you know, as someone who spent 5 years just going on tours of sites dedicated to slavery, you know, I showed up at Monticello at 10 a.m. on a Tuesday with a particular docent, and tour would look different at 11 a.m. on a Thursday or 2 p.m. on a Friday, because it depends on who you're with. It depends on who your guide is. It depends on the sort of texture of the group that you're spending time with. And so, you know, I can see that moment is so fascinating because I think it represents the best of how so much of that tour's experience is shaped by the sort of topography of people who were there alongside you, and that I like that, right? I think it's great for, you know, for there to be guidelines or sort of guideposts for tours, but for docents never for docents to understand that not every tour is or should be the same. And one thing that I also, you know, that I'm thinking about now. There was also the room where they had the audio section. And what was so fascinating also is to hear different guides and different docents have disagreements about or different approaches to the way that they presented the audio, different conceptions of like what ways the audio should be used, which is another reminder that, you know, ultimately, like, this is a home and an institution that is tasked with cultivating and curating and communicating the legacy of a person, of a human being who was imperfect and had their own biases and own prejudices and own ideas and own contributions. And it is the tours of those spaces and of that space are similarly led by humans with their own identities, their own backgrounds, their own notions of what is effective, what is generative, and that's shaped by the range of experiences they bring to the space. So what I loved is just how alive it was and how so much of the space, like you want historic sites to be places that feel alive and that feel like they're constantly engaging in reflection and debate and sort of meditating on like what best practices are and what those look like. And somebody, one guide's best practice might be different than another guide's best practice. So I think those two spaces. And
thanks. That space in the parlor where people get to sit down is one of my favorites as well. But you also got to tour the Mark Twain house right next door, which is a very different kind of house. Twain is a very different kind of person. What resonated with you about that house?
I was, you know, I think what strikes many people immediately is that tour, and I don't know if that was this specific tour or if all of the tours are like this, but was led by a reenactor. And that was fascinating, particularly given that this was a Black reenactor and someone who was reenacting what it meant to be Twain's servant. And so, you know, reenactment is a fascinating and complex task, especially when you are thinking about what responsible, historically responsible and ethically responsible reenacting looks like. And who should be reenacting, who makes the decisions of what should be reenacted. And so what I appreciated, I don't remember the man's name, but I had the opportunity to have a conversation with him afterwards and think and ask him some of the questions about like how he grappled with what it meant to be a person playing a Black servant of Mark Twain and also to be like a Black descendant of enslaved people and then to do this in front of a majority of guests who are white. And he was incredibly thoughtful and had grappled with a lot of these questions. And again, I think it's another example of how there's so many different ways to do this.
Great. But you also got a chance to tour the archives at the center. And Beth, the director of collections there, pulled some items and shared some reports with you about the complexities of categorizing and digitizing items that are racially charged, as many of the Uncle Tom objects are. Tell us about your visit to the archive and ideas that came, that germinated for you from the time in the archives and looking at items that circulate kind of in the legacy of Uncle Tom.
You know, what's interesting, part of what I learned and what I hadn't fully appreciated was the extent to which, like I understood Uncle Tom's Cabin as a book, right? Like I understand that it was a book that sold like hundreds of thousands, millions of copies over time. And I understood its significance as a cultural product in that context. I hadn't fully understood the extent to which that book created an entire sort of cultural ecosystem around it, right? I didn't know about all of the different plays. I didn't know about the way that copyright, you know, how copyright worked back then was that like you didn't need permission from the author to turn their book into a play. People just did. So you had all of these different places and all these different people. And what I got to see in the archives were these different images and these different flyers and these different posters and these different, and some of these are in the public tour as well in the room upstairs, but all of the different ways that people took a product that had a specific intention and then in some ways sort of stripped it of the sort of moral urgency that was embedded within it and the sort of moral orientation that it was sort of, that Stowe would have said was intrinsic to the project and turned it into something else. And you got to see through the archives how this work was transformed into something far more insidious than what it was when it first emerged. And I think also, you know, what's fascinating about Harriet Beecher Stowe is that, like, she was very much a part of that, of the abolitionist space. I think sometimes when we learn about this period of history, or any period of history, really, we can learn about people in silos, and we don't always learn about the ways in which they are, like, engaged with and know each other, right? Like, you know, so to have access to correspondence between Frederick Douglass and Harriet Beecher Stowe, to think about correspondence between William Lloyd Garrison and Harriet Beecher Stowe, to think about who, you know, Harriet Beecher Stowe, the lineage that she comes from, and who her father was, and who he knew, right? And so it's similar to, you know, I've been doing some work recently on the Harlem Renaissance, and, you know, sometimes what happens is you learn about Langston Hughes, and you learn about Zora Neale Hurston, and you learn about County Cullen, and you learn about Paul Laurence Dunbar. But you don't always learn about the ways that they were involved in one another's life, and, like, how they were so deeply enmeshed in each other's lives. And I think that, you know, this trip to the archives and the site more broadly gave me a fuller appreciation for the extent to which she was really a part of that world. And as somebody who was a staff writer at The Atlantic, you know, she was among the first contributors to that project, which began as an abolitionist magazine.
So interesting to think about the network and your Harlem Renaissance work as well. So we think of archives and museums and historic houses as full of things. They're full, full, full. But they're also full of absences and silences, I think. How, as museums and historic sites, as collecting organizations, as organizations who present to the public, how do you think we can more fully address those absences?
I think it demands constant, proactive, ongoing reflection. You know, I think of a place like Monticello. And I think that Monticello is, I often talk about Monticello as a place that represents how historical sites, even the oldest and most famous of historical sites, are not static. And who they are today is not always, and very, you know, especially in the context of a place like Monticello, is not who they have been. So what Monticello was 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago, 5 years ago, is very different than what Monticello is and looks like today. But that doesn't come just, that's not a sort of, like, natural, like, the arc of the museum universe bends towards justice. You need a whole bunch of people pulling down on it together. You need people screaming to say, come down, you know? So, you know, I don't know how far I can extend this metaphor, but I think that it is a place. I was at Monticello this summer for a Juneteenth celebration. And part of that Juneteenth celebration was that they were rededicating the enslaved burial ground where the people who were enslaved at Monticello were buried, some of them with some semblance of a marker and many of them with no marker at all. But when I had visited in 2018, it was a place that seemed to have been an afterthought. It was a place that didn't seem to get a lot of attention, didn't seem to get a lot of care, was not part of the sort of larger curatorial experience at the museum. And I think that over the last several years, as has been the case with many institutions in the midst of the way that the Black Lives Matter movement, I think, has culturally pushed many historic sites to look inward. And I think we saw that was supercharged with George Floyd and everything that happened after the protest of, in the summer of 2020. But Monticello got to that place because there were people demanding that it get there. And there were people in leadership positions who recognized that they had a responsibility, a moral responsibility and an empirical responsibility, right? Because I think that what can happen, what we've seen in the news sometimes, is that people perceive these efforts to recalibrate the sort of historical processes of these sites as an ideological project, as one that is a political project, and not one that's actually grounded in empirical evidence and primary source documents, and an effort to say, actually, we're just trying to tell the full story, given that the full story wasn't told for so long. So it takes thoughtfulness, it takes a sense of responsibility, it takes a discerning ear. And I think some sense of a thick skin, because sometimes people are going to tell you things that will hurt your feelings. And not in a personal way, but like in a way that's saying like, this, you need to do better. You are not doing well enough. You are failing as an institution in these ways. And I think you need people in leadership and people in, who are working there who are open to hearing that and who know that comes with the job.
And I think the emphasis on leadership, and particularly a kind of that this is a, you know, this is an expansion of what we do, not a total shift, but that leaders, both boards of directors and staff leaders, have really important roles to play is such an important point. But as we can see in America today, the teaching of history is under attack more than ever. And historic sites are, of course, not exempt from that. Stowe Center often, the staff, particularly the frontline staff, feels the energy of racist ideas as they give tours and work to express the ways in which the legacy of enslavement still affects all of our lives today. And, you know, I think that's true of so many, many sites in the U.S. So is there advice? Because sometimes people do hear what they don't want to hear, which is about doing better. But sometimes people hear people who are telling them, who are literally attacking frontline staff verbally for trying to do this work that's so important. What advice would you give these frontline staff that are really these days on the front line about how we think about history?
Yeah, they absolutely are on the front lines. I saw that and continue to see that everywhere I go. You know, I've been, obviously How the Word Is Passed is a project that's thinking about how these sites reckon with the history of slavery. I'm sort of in the early stages of thinking about what that looks like in the context of World War II. And thinking about, well, how do historical sites tasked with communicating different facets of the World War II experience for different groups of people, whether it was Japanese American prisoners in the prison camps on the West Coast, whether it was people along Navajo reservations who were put in boarding schools one day and then told that they needed to come serve in the Marines to use their language to create codes for the military the next day, to, you know, what. All of these different, all the people who work in these places have their own relationship to this experience. And I think those relationships animate their desire to even, that their sort of what brings them to this work in the first place. And I think part of what, the thing that I found in the docents that I spent time with, who I think of as the sort of exemplars, is that there was both the extension of grace and generosity, but also an expectation of accountability and responsibility, which is to say that, you know, you have 45 minutes or an hour, you know, with folks on these tours max, and there is a lot to that one has to try to pack into that without overwhelming people. And I think that one of the things that I saw people do best was give space for people to process stories or ideas that they had not encountered before. Recognize that those will look, those will be varying degrees of inelegant, and that you might not always get the generosity from visitors that you are attempting to extend to the visitors. You know, so the folks that I spent time with at Whitney Plantation, Cello, New York, and Angola, and, and at the Stowe Center, I think so much of what they do well was recognize that when somebody shows up to the Stowe Center, for example, not everybody, you know, some people are like, oh, like Uncle Tom's Cabin, I read that in high school, like that's, you know, it's right next to Mark Twain's house, let's go see, we can't wait, you know, let's see some Harry Beecher Stowe. And then they go in and they see a James Baldwin quote where it was like, paraphrasing, but like, this is an irresponsible two-dimensional caricature and rendering of Black people. That's going to be jarring for folks. And I think it's important to give, I certainly haven't encountered anybody who did this. No one does this at the Stowe Center, but I think more broadly, to give space for people to process that, and to not judge them or harangue them or make them feel small for not knowing this type of information, but also, to the extent that's possible, create a space in which there is the sort of mutual social contract of your group, where it's like, you know, my end of the social contract is I'm going to share this information with you and do it in a way that doesn't judge you or condemn you or harangue you. But the part of your end of that social contract is that you have to sit with this and you have to wrestle with it. And you have to, even when it's hard, even when it's jarring, even if it runs counter to all the stories your grandpappy told you as a kid, you know, like that. And that's tough, because the way that people understand who they are in relation to this history, American history in particular, and the various characters and actors within American history, is that when you begin to question or create cracks, or not even cracks, that's probably not the correct framing, but sort of additional tentacles of like who those folks are, you are also sort of, you are calling into question or complicating the story of who many people believe themselves to be, because we tell ourselves stories based on the stories we've been told, and the stories we've been told are inevitably tied to the story of a country that we've been told, you know, different people have been told different things about, but that so many folks have been told, told is this sort of unquestionable meritocratic bastion of goodness, and that we have only ever been on an upward justice-oriented trajectory. And as we know, that's not the case.
So you've raised a really interesting question. The 250th celebration of this country's founding is coming up in 2026. And the museum and public history field, and historians as well, I guess, are really beginning these conversations about, well, what is it we're celebrating here? From your perspective, what is it you think we might be celebrating or could be celebrating? And how would you do it if you were in charge?
You know, America is a place that has provided unparalleled, unimaginable, remarkable opportunities for millions of people across generations in ways that their own ancestors could have never imagined. It has also done so at the direct expense of millions and millions of other people who have been intergenerationally subjugated and oppressed. And both of those things are the story of America. It's not one over here and one over there. It's that they are both deeply interwoven and entangled within one another. And I don't know how to tell a story about America in any other way. Right? I mean, that's it. Like, America is a place that is phenomenal and remarkable and unlike any nation that has ever existed in the history of the world in so many ways. And it's in so many other ways, it has done things to people in ways that are more horrific than anywhere else in the history of the world. And if we are a place that wants to become the best version of itself, or us continue to aspire toward the best version of itself, the only way to do that, and you know, folks in the public history space think about this all the time, the only way to do that is to tell the story in its totality. And that's not a sort of ideological project. It's one that is grounded in the deep, deep care for this country, a deep love for this country, a deep desire for this country to be what it is said that it is, but what we know that it is not yet. I would make sure that we, you know, I think part of the battle of the what we see in the years ahead will clearly be pushing back against some of these policies that are attempting to prevent teachers, you know, in the state legislatures that are attempting to prevent teachers from teaching the very reason that our country looks the way that it does today, or school boards who are attempting to prevent books from being taught that provide young people with perspectives that they might not otherwise ever encounter. And so, you know, as we approach 250 years, we're also in the midst of an effort, from often a state-sanctioned effort, from people who are attempting to make the story of America one that is simply incorrect and one that is incomplete. And that is not benign. That is something that has dangerous implications. And we see that. We saw it on January 6th. We saw it throughout the Black Lives Matter movement. We continue to see it today with the, you know, in the ways that I feel like our democracy is sort of hanging on by a thread. And that's grounded in a sort of profound collective ahistoricism that so many people in this country carry every single day.
And the challenge of meeting that ahistoricism is a pretty tough one. And so I'm going to go from the big U.S. 250th to zooming back into Hartford. Hartford is the third poorest city in the United States. And yet it's also a beautiful historical city filled with culture and social history and beautiful communities and community members. So when you toured the neighborhood with staff, part of which is about what has been preserved, which is both what has been emerged from a systemic design of any city these days with highways and everything else. Part of the question I think Stowe Center is beginning to try and really think about more is, and this is a question for any museum, particularly ones in more urban areas, how can a museum be a better neighbor?
Yeah, I think it's a question that that a lot of places are wrestling with. And when we say museums, you know, in some ways, we're also talking about universities. I think we're also talking about a lot of sites, a lot of places with historical roots that are part of communities where their history and what they have done and what their relationship to those communities have been have very often not been ones grounded in a sense of collectivism, but instead is one that has been shaped by exploitation, one that has been shaped by erasure, and one that has been shaped by neglect. And so, and in some ways, those sort of their contemporary extensions of those make it so that various sort of degrees of that continue to manifest itself from a lot of these places today if they're not thoughtful about it. You know, I think the most important way and the best way is to move with and to enter spaces with a profound sense of humility. And that doesn't mean that everything the other party says is correct. Right, it is humility and a desire to listen is different than thinking that everything the institution believes is wrong and everything the community believes is right. It's a dialogue, right? Things are never that simple. Things are never that black and white, and different places and different communities are also not monolithic, right? Like communities are filled with the same way that, you know, when we are in the parlor of the Stowe Center, or rather, I think this was in Harriet's room or one of the bedrooms upstairs where they had the audio. The same way that listen to multiple guides have different ideas of like what, how to effectively use the audio in that room, whether to use it, whether it was ethical, whether it was unethical, and to do so not in ways that were calling into question a person's personhood, or like sense of like their own moral obligation, but just a disagreement and a debate and an exchange of ideas of what is and isn't an effective part of sort of that curatorial pedagogy. I think similarly, there are people in communities who will have very different ideas of what responsibility to that community looks like, and it may be true that. And I think we have to accept when we talk about communities, we shouldn't talk about them as if they are monolithic entities, that they all believe this or everyone thinks that, but that we lean into and wrestle with the complexity in front of us, even when it doesn't create the sort of neat answers and the clean solutions that we want it to. And it's got to be a conversation in a relationship that is ongoing, right? Not a sort of like we talked to them when we first moved in and then we haven't talked to anybody in the community since. You know, it's asking questions And community is both those who are physically proximate to the institution, but also community is far more expansive than that, right? Like community is the local public schools, community is the churches, community is the local businesses, community is, you know, the people who, the activists. And I think that extends to the larger Hartford community, not just necessarily the people within the radius of the center itself.
Great. So I'm curious, is there a historic site that you're just dying to go visit and you haven't had a chance yet?
Oh, that's such a good question. A historic site that I haven't had the opportunity to visit.
Or a museum. I'll take museum, either one.
I really want to spend more time in, it's not a particular museum, as much as it in an area, like if I could go back and at, like people ask me, like, would I change anything about the book? I really wish I could have written a chapter on the history of slavery in California. California's relationship to enslavement was, because I think it's a place that, you know, I have New York in my chapter, and people, you know, I think many people now recognize that New York was not immune to enslavement, both by the fact that it was at one point the second largest slave market in the country, and by the fact that even when slavery was outlawed in the city limits and in the state, it benefited profoundly, economically, socially, politically, from the existence of the slaveocracy of the South. But California, the whole West Coast, is a place that people never really think about in terms of what slavery looked like or how it manifested itself there. And so I would, you know, I know there are a lot of historians and scholars, and I think different museums to varying degrees across the state that are, especially over the last several years, have begun to more directly grapple with that history. And I think that it's, you know, I'm often drawn to, one of the reasons I love being a writer is that I find myself drawn to things that I, far from being an expert on, I feel like I don't know enough about. Like it's much more interesting for me to realize that I don't know enough about something and try to chase down information about it and learn information about it so that it feels generative for me. And that's what How the Word Is Passed was. I didn't begin this project as an expert on the history of slavery. I began this project as a man who was watching the statues in New Orleans that he grew up around topple down. And then who was like, why didn't I ever question that there was a 60-foot tall statue of Robert E. Lee in the middle of the city? Like, why was that so normal to me? And what are the ways that a society normalizes things that are that should never be normal? And what are the sort of historical and social implications of that? And why did I never know that New Orleans was the busiest slave market in the country at the mouth of the Mississippi? Like, what, and how does that shape me? How does that shape? So all that's to say, I would have loved to write a chapter on that because I want to learn more about it for myself. So maybe it'll be an article for the Atlantic.
Right. I'm sure now people will be sending you emails going, please come to California.
If you have information, please.
And think about it. So the International Council of Museums, which is the big global organization that represents museums around the world, after a long, long consultative process, adopted a new definition of museums because museums have a need to define themselves. And there's a couple sentences in it that I'd love to hear about what you think they actually mean from your perspective. They, of course, are nonprofit, they collect, blah, blah, blah. But then it says that museums are, quote, open to the public, accessible and inclusive. Museums foster diversity and sustainability. They operate and communicate ethically, professionally, and with the participation of communities, offering varied experiences for education. So I'm curious, what does it mean to you for museums to communicate ethically?
It's such an interesting statement as a whole. And we've kind of touched on this a bit, but I'm thinking about that line, like that's talking about what how museums do the work they do in community, and then with the participation of other people, and it just really reinforces the idea that the most successful museum spaces are not unidirectional in their approach. I almost, it makes me think of a book that was really seminal for me when I was a high school English teacher, was Paulo Freire's Pedagogy of the Oppressed. And part of the, you know, there are a lot of sort of theories and tenets in there, but one of the things that he talks about is, you know, how it's important for teachers not to go into a classroom and think that they are like a container that is like filling a bunch of empty cups or empty jars, and like that's what teaching is, right? That it is not that you a bunch of people with this sort of metaphorical emptiness are entering the space, but instead that they are people who have really rich contributions to offer both the teacher in the space and the sort of community within it. And so, and I think that there's a similar thing to some of the best museum practices, right? And that's reflected in the way Stowe Center is, you know, has spaces where people are exchanging conversations, you know, are in conversation with one another and not just with the guide. And so I think that's a really important thing. And I don't think that that's necessarily something that all museums are doing. Like, I think some, there are museums as there are teachers, as there are, you know, all sorts of folks who think of their job as to like bestow information, pour information into people, and then after 45 minutes they leave. And I think it's much richer to engage in that exchange of ideas. And then in terms of what it means to do so ethically, I mean, I really think that like constant, you know, and I feel like I'm repeating myself, but empathy, humility, and constant reflection, like, are 90% of it, right? If you are a place and you are a leadership and you wake up every day saying, I'm going to try to make my institution a little bit better, a little bit fuller, a little bit more honest, a little bit more responsible than it was yesterday, and that you recognize that you won't wake up and sort of magically be bestowed with knowledge of how to do so, but that that instead comes from, like, again, a humility of leadership to be in conversation with all sorts of different stakeholders, descendants, community members, museum board members, local schools. I mean, like, there's so many people who are stakeholders in those space in ways that we don't always and we don't always define the mistakes. So I think it's just constant empathy, humility, and reflection. And if you do those things, then I think you're going to be constantly figuring out how to become, get closer to the version of yourself that you hope your institution will be.
So that raises, right, we do all that reflection, and sometimes that reflection means really thinking about how we failed at something. Right, often, probably more often than any of us want. But in doing this work of empathy, humility, and reflection, I'm guessing you must have had at least some failure in your own life as a writer. I'm curious about how you think about that in terms of how it shapes your work and how it helps you move forward.
Yeah, I mean, you know, one of the things that I was going to add that I didn't say is, operating with the expectation that, like, you will spend, you will have your focus groups, you will have your listening sessions, you will have your white papers, you will talk to the scholars, you will talk, and you will create an entirely new framework, an entirely new approach, entirely new exhibits, and still, you may get it wrong, right? Like, I think that that's one of the hardest parts of this. And I think that's most similar to being a writer. I mean, what a lot of people don't know about how the word is passed, and I think, you know, every writer is different, but I think it's a similar story for many of us who publish books. You know, I wrote probably 30 to 40,000 words before I got to the first word of this book. I wrote three chapters that I thought were the first chapter over the course of like a year. And, you know, I wrote 10,000 words and I was like, no, this isn't it. I wrote 15,000 words. I was like, no, this isn't it. I wrote another 15,000 words. I know this. And that's a year of my life, right? Like that's a lot. That's time. That's research. That's, you know, time that I'm not spending with my children. Time that I'm not, you know, binging on Netflix. Time that I'm not, you know, like eating French fries and chicken wings. You know, I'm just naming my favorite pastimes. And I think there's a way, I tell this to young writers especially. Sometimes when people sit down to write and when it does, when like the what they imagine as the final product doesn't come to them immediately, they think that they're not meant to be a writer, or their writing's too hard for them, or they're not a good writer. But you cannot compare what is in the final draft, the 12th draft of how the word is passed, to what it meant to sit down at, with that blinking cursor in front of you in 2017 and saying, like, what am I trying to say? And I think about it the same way that I played sports my whole life. And, you know, for a long time, I thought I was going to be a professional soccer player. And then you grow up and you realize that Louisiana is not a hotbed of soccer talent against which to measure your skills on a global scale. And so I did not become a professional soccer player. But I think all the time about what sports instilled in me was this sense that you don't just show up to the game and like score three goals or score 30 points or throw five touchdowns or, you know, do whatever. That doesn't just happen like when you show up on Saturday. You put in hours and hours and thousands of hours of work on the practice field that people will never see. But you do that work so that the final product in the game is the sort of manifestation of that work. And for me, being a writer is the same thing, right? I spend much more time writing things that people will never see. But I have to write those things because it allows me, it creates the sort of possibilities for me to write that which will be in a book or will be in an article or will be in a poem. You know, I've written like 1,000 poems over my life. And, you know, I have one book that has like 53 of them. And so I think that's what being a writer is. It's just I wake up and fail every day. And I accept that that is part of the deal. I accept that that is, I don't even think of it as like a tax. I think of it the same way that a athlete thinks about practice, or the same way that a musician thinks about practice. You know, you don't just show up to the concert and play like Beethoven. You have to put in a lot of work that people will never see. So yeah.
But that's, to be honest, that's like great advice for museums and historic sites, because we don't really think that way. But I understand you're working on a new book of poetry. We're going to ask you to read a poem for us, and then we'll have time for some questions. So please share what you're, something you're working on.
Yeah, this is a book, this poem or this book has, when I was writing How the Word is Passed, I was thinking a lot about obviously how these different historical sites reckon with their relationship to the history of slavery. And that process was shaped in large part by the fact that I became a father while I was working on this book. So, you know, my son is now 5, my daughter's now 3. My son was born the same month I began sort of ideating around this project. And it inevitably recalibrated and reshaped the way that I thought about what I was writing. I was now studying slavery and the implications of slavery as someone who had a family of his own. And it was impossible for me to strip that lens from the approach that I took when I was at these places, and specifically thinking about the way that slavery stripped millions of families apart in ways that I hadn't fully grappled with, I think, before I had children of my own. I hadn't grappled with the sort of emotional devastation that that would enact on a family. So I got really interested in, you know, as people who've read the book know, there is being a father is shows up in all sorts of different ways in different chapters. But I realized that there was more to say. There was more that I wanted to say about fatherhood. And so I wrote a book of poems about being a dad, becoming a dad. And so the book is a bunch of dad poems. It will be out in March of next year, so about 6 months from now. And I will read, I'll read two different poems. They're relatively short, but that could sort of capture the sort of range of emotional textures that the book is trying to capture of parenthood. Your national anthem. Today, a black man who was once a black boy like you got down on one of his knees and laid his helmet on the grass as this country sang its ode to a promise it never kept. And the woman in the grocery store line in front of us is on the phone, and she is telling someone on the other line that this black man who was once a black boy like you should be grateful we live in a country where people aren't killed for things like this. You know, she says, in some places they would hang you for such a blatant act of disrespect. Maybe he should go live there instead of here so he can appreciate what he has. And then she turns around and sees you sitting in the grocery store cart, surrounded by lettuce and yogurt and frozen chicken thighs. And you smile at her with your toothless gum smile. And she says that you are the cutest baby she has ever seen and tells me how I must feel so lucky to have such a beautiful baby boy. And I thank her for her kind words, even though I know I should not thank her, because I know that you will not always be a black boy, but one day you may be a black man, and you may decide your country hasn't kept its promise to you either. And this woman, or another like her, will forget you were ever this boy and will make you into something else and tell you to be grateful for what you've been given. I'll read this one. Ossicles. My son tells me that his favorite animal is the giraffe. Yesterday it was the hippopotamus. The day before it was the zebra. Last week it was the beluga whale. But today it is the giraffe. So we watch videos of this tall, gangly creature with its long neck, black eyes, and horns unlike any horns we have seen before. And my son asks me why the giraffe has horns. And I tell him I actually don't know, and that when I was his age, I thought the giraffe must have just had an extra pair of ears. My son says, giraffes don't have four ears, Daddy. That would make them aliens. And of course he is correct. Of course those cannot be ears. Of course the idea of a four-eared creature is reserved for extraterrestrials we imagine when we look up at the stars. But on the giraffe, they're called ossicles, though we decide to call them horns anyway. And it turns out they don't do much of anything but exist as an heirloom passed down from ancestors who had far more use for these protrusions of cartilage than their long-necked descendants. And I look at my son and think of all the things I might try to give him that he will one day have no need for. The things that serve no function other than being ornaments of all of a time that came before. The things that continue to make us who we are long after they have served their purpose.
Thank you so much for a great conversation and those poems. I'm really looking forward to the book. And as always, it was great to talk to you. We're now going to shift Amy Huffnagel of the Stowe Center, I think, has some audience questions for you. Amy.
Thank you. Wow, there's so much to reflect on in the conversation, and we are so much better for our conversations with you this year and what you bring to the museum field. So thank you for all of that. And thank you for all of you who are out there, not with us on site tonight. I am getting a message from Wendy Kaufman, who's writing in to us from West Hartford, talking specifically about the chapter that you wrote about Blandford Cemetery and speaking with members of the Sons of the Confederate Veterans. And she puts in quotes, "What would it take," or she's quoting you, "what would it take for you to confront the false history, even if it means shattering the stories you have been told throughout your whole life?" I'm a former history teacher, she writes, and she wonders really what it will take for us to educate students to be willing to confront the history, the story.
I think you have to teach, you know, and this is what so many great history teachers do, but like teach the folks who are sort of central actors and central characters in our history as people, right? Like these are just human beings who were doing what they thought was the best thing, even when it wasn't. You know, I think, you know, when you begin to think of Jefferson or Lincoln or Harry Beecher Stowe or Frederick Douglass as imperfect human beings who had things they did that were remarkable and things they did that were shameful, then I think it allows us to see more of ourselves in them, because that's what we do every day. We are people who do things that are remarkable. We are people who do things that we're ashamed of. And I think that that's what it means to be human. Obviously, there are varying degrees of this, right? But I do think it is important that we disabuse students of the idea that these people are, that the people who do things that we understand as consequential in this country, in this world, are simply people. Who have been put in some staggering positions over the course of history, and that they are people just like us. And the more that we can understand that, the more we can understand why history is a messy, complex place, because we are a messy and complex species.
Great. It actually leads to a question that Beth and I, as staff at the Stowe Center, were batting around, a question that we wished we could ask you. And I just have to go forward since you brought your family into the conversation. And we were wondering, what stories are you reading to your kids? What stories are you loving as a family these days?
Oh, man, there's so many. There's so many good children's books. I admire children's book writers because they're just like, they're great and they're so delightful. My kids love, I mean, you know, it's an old classic. They love The Hungry, Hungry Caterpillar, just like Brown Bear, What Did You See? Gerald the Giraffe, Gerald the Dancing Giraffe is a big, big thing. All of the children's books by Jacqueline Woodson, who is just like a national treasure. I was reading Jackie Woodson books when I was a kid, and now my kids are reading Jackie Woodson books. And she's not even old. She's just like, I mean, she's remarkable. It's and I feel lucky to count her as a friend now. What else do we love? Amazing Grace was a book that I read when I was a kid. I can't remember the author now, but Amazing Grace. We love, my kids love Pete the Cat. Man, they love Pete the Cat. They just will read any Pete the Cat book out there. I love when he says groovy. That's like their favorite word now. Like, groove, that's groovy. Just like,
what you're making so visible for me is just the power of the story, right? That the story just is the thing that we know first and we keep on repeating and loving. I have another question here. This question comes actually as an unanswered question from Stowe Prize Part 1 in June, and that we wanted to bring forward. And was also resonated with some of our staff conversations that, you know, we feel like museums do have this responsibility as cultural institutions to make sure that, you know, we're as inclusive and diverse as possible inside the museum. And that has to matter to the way history is told. And I wonder what should history sites do to be more diverse and more inclusive on the inside within the stories that they're telling?
I'm part of it is what, you know, the Stowe Center is doing so well, and others, I think, getting into the archives, right? And I think, but not only getting into the archives, but a place that a lot of things are, something that a lot of these places are doing well now is also thinking about the role oral histories play and sort of the non-traditional histories, you know, which is to say, you know, so much of what we use in our process to curate a museum experience is based on letters and is based on, you know, these sort of physical primary sources that we have from this time. And I think part of what we should recognize, and what many places again do recognize, is that primary sources cannot only be limited to that which is written down, that which is physically legible, but also has to include the perspectives and stories of people who had, for various reasons, didn't have the opportunity to write their stories down, or whose stories weren't written down, but whose stories were transmitted in other ways. So I think that's a big part of it, is sort of opening and expanding our conception of what legitimate stories and legitimate histories are and where they come from.
Right. Let's end tonight with a question that came in from Massachusetts, where you end your book by saying that we must reckon with our history. How do we reckon? How do we do that?
Ended on a big question. How do we do that? You know, again, I hate to like feel like I'm a sort of jukebox on repeat right now, but I just find that moving with empathy, generosity, humility, and constant reflection, both on individual levels and on institutional levels, is the most important thing. Reckoning is less of an external process than it is an internal one. I think reckoning happens inside of us before it happens to outside in the world. excuse me. And so I think it's really important to wake up every day and recognize that there's so much more to learn. You know, that's it. It doesn't have to be a burden. I wake up every day feeling that, and it feels exciting. Like, you know, I'm just like, man, I could have spent the rest of my life researching how the word is passed. But you know, publishing contracts mean you have to put it out at some point. But I think the world is such a remarkable place. Our history in this country, in our communities, are so robust, and there's so much to learn. So much to understand and so much to try to grapple with. And I think that's something that shouldn't be understood as a burden or an obstacle, but as like a really exciting opportunity.
Such a beautiful place to end our conversation with you, not the event, but end the conversation with you. Thank you for being so generous with us. And we do want to keep learning from you and with you. My cup runneth over this evening, to use the cup metaphor for a moment. Linda, you're a great conversant. Thank you so much for being part of the conversation and the work at the Stowe Center. It was really a beautiful conversation.
Ourselves. We're tired of beating our head against the wall and working for someone else.